IAAF Inside Athletics is the show, and I am the host. My name is Atto Bolden. Welcome once again. We are in season six, thanks to fans like you. My guest today is one of Australia's brightest rising stars. Literally, he was seventh at the recent World Championships in the pole vault. It's my pleasure to welcome Curtis Marshall. Nice to meet you, Curtis.
Cheers, man. Thank you.
So you are coming off of a seventh place finish in the World Championships. I read where you said, I am starting to feel like I belong in this sport. But you made the Olympic team last year in 2016. You didn't feel like you belonged having made the Olympic team for Australia?
Well, I just scraped in that competition. It wasn't feeling of accomplishment just yet. I knew there was a little bit more to come. Mm-hmm. And I know I'm young and I was stoked to be there. Don't get me wrong. Like, the Olympic Games, absolutely amazing. But then once I got on to a few Diamond Leagues this year and then I got to World Championships and I made the final, I was like, all right, these are my boys out here. This is where I belong. This is the thing that I do. This is what I love. And yeah, it was the best feeling knowing that, you know, it's not just a one-off sort of thing. I know that I've got that company now and I know that I can repeat and repeat and then just keep coming out and performing at my best and then enjoying the atmosphere knowing that I belong there.
So in Rio, you were out early. In London at the World Championships, you did obviously significantly better. What were sort of the lessons from Rio that you took to London that helped you to get to the final?
Yeah, see, Rio was the first major championship. I sort of skipped, yeah. Oh, I skipped the Commonwealth Games, I skipped the World Champs, I went straight to the Olympics, the pinnacle.
Right.
And I was like blown off my feet. Like I could not deal with it. I went to the World Junior Championships a few months before, incomparable.
And you got silver there.
And I got silver, which was good. And I managed to cope with the nerves there and the pressure there. But going to the Olympic Games amongst all the men of the sport compared to all the boys, it's totally different. And what I took away from Rio was being able to handle myself under that pressure is the ability to either block it out, absorb it, or change the way you go about things. So I enjoy the crowd. I use them if I can.
So you absorbed it?
I absorbed it. So if you can channel that energy from the Olympic Games or the World Championships and use it and then use it in your performance, you're going to come out better. And when I was in the Olympics for the first time, had no idea what I was doing, and I just fell to pieces. Like, a few days before the competition, I didn't really know what to expect.
Right.
And then walking out there, it was just like mind-blowing stuff. Like, because there was a Brazilian in my field, the Olympic champion.
Right.
As soon as he came on, like, everything, like, deafening. You couldn't hear yourself think. And I definitely couldn't pole vault, like, with that ruckus happening in the background. So being able to learn to either switch it off or switch it on whenever I needed to was the biggest thing. And I used that to my advantage in London, managed to channel it and jump all right.
Now, you don't have to go too far back in your country's history to find a pole vault Olympic and world champion. Tell me about how much the influence of your country's recent past in the event has sort of propelled you.
Yeah, well, to go not too far back, Steve Hooker, bloody legend. I actually
have been on the show, friend of the show.
Has he?
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah, he's a super nice guy. And he's one of probably my biggest idols in the sport. He was the one that took pole vaulting to that next level in Australia. There were a few guys before him, Dmitry Markov, Tatiana for the girls, that was pretty big. But then Steve, going Olympic champion, world indoor champion, like Commonwealth Games champion, ridiculous. And to be able to have him in my back pocket and have a chat to him, you know, once a month, talk about technical stuff, what advice has he got, what's he thinking. Like, I'll send him videos and he just comments on a few of the things that he thinks that he's learned from his career and gives it to me. It's not this competition of, oh, who's better. It's he's there and he's helping me, because we have, he had Stefan Kyle as his manager and I have Stefan as well. Okay. So we share that common ground, and he told me stories about how he lived on the circuit in Europe, how much he loved it. And then I went and lived it last year, and it was bloody awesome.
So I hear you rattling off the names of the people who have sort of carried the torch in your event for your country. Are you a student of the sport? Are you one of these athletes who can quote and remember and cite things that have happened in the recent past and in the distant past in your event?
100%. I think that if you want to excel at your sport, it's something you got to learn. It's something that you got to get super good at, almost like undertake a degree in your sport. So I think of myself as a student of the sport. I love the stats. I love following it each year. And I used to remember watching the Diamond League series every single year.
Oh, wow.
Last year, I just happened to be on it in all the meets, and that was just surreal.
So I think all pole vaulters have to have a little bit of crazy in them to go upside down over something 19, 20 feet in the air. What is the thing that drew you to this event? What about your personality looked at this event and went, oh yeah, I can do that, I want to do this?
It's a little bit different for me. I was never amazing at like one thing. I was never really born a sprinter or born a distance runner. I was all right at everything, but then I got the opportunity to try pole vault. And I was like, damn, that looks fun. And I stuck at it. I was never great to start with because it's a really technical event. It takes years and years. It's not, you're not born with it like sprinting.
Mm-hmm.
So I stuck at it for years. And I like the idea that there's never going to be a perfect jump.
Right.
So I love striving for perfection, but I'm always knowing that there's always going to be something better. There's always going to be something more that I can do next jump to make me jump higher. And I just love that aspect of the pole vault because it's such a demanding sport, both on your body and your mind, but knowing that there's always something more that you can do, no matter how happy you think you feel or down in the dumps you are, there's always something more. And I just love that pursuit.
So you're the sheriff sort of in your region of the world. And then you go to Europe and there's Sheriff Mondo over in Sweden. So my first reaction is, this event clearly is in very good hands going forward because between the two of you, you are jumping heights that for your age are really, really remarkable. But tell me about your rivalry with Mondo.
Mondo and I, best mates. It's absolutely awesome. Yeah, I researched him a lot before I came up to him at World Junior Champs last year.
Right.
I was like, oh, what's this gonna be about? And went to the track, said hi. Instant connection. We're like, pole vault, we're the boys. This is awesome. Get on the track, talking between jumps is awesome. Really good connection with the guy. And I respect him a lot because he's been vaulting for so long and has so much to offer.
Yeah.
It's not like you can just have a standard like talk with him about pole vaulting. It's like this guy knows his gear.
He's
young. He's like 18 this year.
Right. That's why he's younger than you are.
He's younger than me. And he probably knows more than me. And I respect that a lot because there's always people out there that are going to be better than you or at least have something else to offer. And I love the way that Mondo goes about it. He's not going to be, you know, this arrogant, you know, go out there, I'm the best sort of thing.
Right.
Even though he may be one day. But I love that he's always got something to share. He's always willing to have a joke. And when it's on the track, you know, we're always out there for each other. It's a really good connection that we have amongst all the pole vaulters, in fact. It's not like sprinting where it's like, it's me, not you. Like,
right.
Yeah, pole vaulters, we share this good connection. And, you know, if your coach doesn't happen to be there on the day or something like that, you're willing to get their foot, you're willing to watch the wind, you're willing to just help out whenever. Because you know you're out there for ages. You've got to be mates, otherwise you're just going to lose it. Because if you're stressing out, then it's no good.
You compete for Australia, the country that I think is the most passionate of any country on earth about sports. Tell me about what it's like walking into that Olympic stadium with Team Australia in Rio.
Team Australia written on my jacket. That was just surreal. Only thing I can compare it to is Aussie rules football, you know that?
Of course, yeah.
Is the AFL grand final. I've never been to it, but I've watched it on TV. 100,000 people packed the Melbourne cricket ground.
Mm-hmm.
And I could imagine that vibe there compared to the Rio Olympics, probably almost comparable because the Olympic Games is the whole world, obviously.
Of course, only in Australia would say this.
you're
comparing Aussie rules final to the Olympic opening ceremony. Keep going. Don't let me stop you. Go ahead. I just thinking to myself, only an Australian would say this.
Yeah, only an Australian. But yeah, that's the only thing I can compare it to because we love Aussie rules
of
footy.
Of course.
But we love sport. We love all sport.
Yes.
And the 2000 Olympic Games was just off the charts. So to carry that into the Rio Olympics and walking out there in the stadium, just mind-blowing stuff.
Now, you mentioned the Sydney Olympic Games. You had to be, what, three when they happened?
Three.
Tell me about, this is an era now where, the whole importance of the Olympic Games is being questioned. And it's not like before where everybody lines up to host. But even though you were obviously a toddler still, tell me what for you, the effect of knowing that your country has hosted the Olympic Games a couple of times and most recently in 2000. Has that had any influence on you and what you want to be as an Olympian?
I think it has. I think that knowing that the Australia has such a rich history in the Olympics, whether it be swimming, whether it be track and field, like memories like Kathy Freeman in 2000 or Steve in 2008 spring to mind as soon as you say Olympics. And in Australia, the Olympic Games is like, it's a household thing. Everyone gets around it. Everyone knows everything to do with the Olympic Games. If you don't, you're crazy.
Right.
And I think that has a positive impact on the sport itself. Because if you have all that backing of your whole nation, your whole country, the government, everything, then they help you. They help, drive you to get there because it's such a big thing.
Right.
You want to fill those shoes. You want to be able to go to that next Olympic Games, fulfill that, wear the green and gold, and do your country proud. So I think it's probably one of the best things you can do for your country.
I said I think all pole vaulters have to have a little bit of crazy. What's the most crazy off-the-track thing that you're into?
Off the track?
Yeah.
I'm pretty tame.
Really? No dirt bike riding, no hang gliding,
no mountain climbing? No.
Nothing like that?
Renault is into his motorbikes, I know that. Yeah. But I ain't that crazy, no. I like surfing. There's good surf spots in Australia. It's easy though, like everyone in Australia surfs. Really? If you don't, you know. I'm pretty tame. I like to keep it chill because I spend all my energy pole vaulting, and that's tough enough as it is. So you can't be crazy at one thing, crazy at another. You won't have enough crazy.
I know a lot of track and field athletes write their goals down in the mirror or whatever. Do you do that? And if you do, whether or not you do, what are the goals that you've set for yourself after, making the final now and, as you say, feeling like you're starting to belong to this fraternity?
Yeah, it's a good feeling knowing that I belong there now. Because I watched the Olympic final in Rio from the stands. And I was like to my coach, I was sitting next to him, I was like, I don't want to be watching this. I want to be doing it next time. Whenever there's a next time, I want to be out there. I'm not going to be sitting and watching.
Right.
So I set myself that goal of doing it in London. Did it. Tick the box. Seventh, top eight, that's pretty good.
Yes.
But then knowing that it's pole vault and knowing there's always something better to do, always something more that you can ask of yourself, then I've got this idea that if I improve my technique, the amount that I improve my speed and my strength, and it all balances itself. If I just improve 1% in one of those things, that's 3. That's 3%. And if you keep adding that each year, if I've jumped 570 as I have now, add 3% of 570, that's 15 centimeters. So if I can add 15 centimeters, yeah, exactly. So if I can keep adding percentages on percentages on percentages and keep striving towards that goal of perfection, no matter what it is, no matter if it's, 640 eventually, but at the moment, it's probably, 585, 590 next season. Be good to give Mondo a run for his money. the Commonwealth Games are in Australia in April. So very much looking forward to that. We've got good company over there with Sean Barber. It's probably going to be 585, 590 to take that title. So that's the aim.
Well, I think your personality is one of the most engaging in the sport. I love to see young, well-rounded gentlemen entering the sport. Congratulations on your great World Championships finish and all the best in the future.
Thank you so much.